Good evening, everybody. Did everybody have a good day today? All right. Boy, we just couldn't have asked for a more picture-perfect Monday at Peniel for whatever you found yourself doing today. It was the perfect day for it. And today is also a perfect day to spend some time here in the tabernacle with our friends from KMBC. So we are going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to turn things right over to them. So would you stand with me, please? Father, thank you for all your blessings upon us. Thank you for this beautiful day that you have given us. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity that many of us had to just enjoy the beauty of this whole world that you've given us. And we thank you for the opportunity that we had and for the safety that you gave us. And now, Lord, as we enter into this worship service, we pray that your Holy Spirit would move in and among us. We pray that we would allow in our hearts and our minds the freedom for your Spirit to move as you would desire. Bless these young men as they share with us this evening in song. In Jesus' name, amen.
Apart from his command, and what will keep us to the end, the love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is his grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ.
So sing hallelujah.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Shall we sing? Christ he lives, Christ he lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life within. There we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ Christ, our hope in life and death. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess. Christ, our hope in life and death. Now and ever we confess. Christ, our hope in life and death.
Amen. Amen. Well, we are gathered here together to worship the Lord. Not we, but we, the body of God. So let's worship Him tonight in one accord. Amen.
We are gathered together with hearts joining as one to celebrate Jesus, great things He has done.
And though in some ways we are different,
the truth is we're one and the same. United by love for the one who has given His grace. We are the people called out of darkness, rescued by mercy, delivered from shame. We are the chosen, loved before Eden, finding salvation in only one name.
Those who forever were changed by the cross.
We are the people, we are the people of God.
Amen.
We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, oh, but not in despair.
Persecuted, but never forsaken.
Cast down, but never destroyed. 'Cause we know this power and strength in the name of the Lord. We are the people called out of darkness, rescued by mercy, delivered from shame. We are the chosen, loved before Eden, finding salvation in only one name.
Those who forever were changed by the cross.
We are the people, we are the people of Jesus, Savior, glory and honor and praise. Blessed Redeemer, worthy of honor and praise. We are the people called out of darkness, rescued by mercy, delivered from shame. We are the chosen, loved before Eden, finding salvation in only one name.
Those who forever were changed by the cross.
We are the people, we are the people of God. We are the people of God. We are the people of God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Aren't you so thankful that we are the people of God? No longer are we still slaves to sin, but we have been brought back by the blood of Jesus Christ from the darkness into his marvelous light. It is so good to be back at Peniel Holiness Camp. We are Kentucky Mountain Bible College, Rejoice Trio. My name is Gideon. I'm from Rwanda. It's a country in East Africa, and God has called me to go into all the nations and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is so good to be back here with you all.
Hello, my name is Nathan. I'm a sophomore at KMBC, and over the past couple of years, the Lord has cultivated in me a passion for his word and for his people. I'm from West Frankfort, Illinois, and he has called me into pastoral ministry.
Well, good evening, y'all. Do you guys say y'all? Amen there in the back. I know David Spencer says y'all. Amen? Amen. Well, hello, y'all. My name's Stephen, and this is my second time here. And I've been a Christian now for just over 3 years. And in that time, God saved me, sanctified me, called me to youth ministry and missions. And the Lord has me ministering in this capacity right now. And I'm so glad to be here with you guys. And in that last song that we just sang, talking about we are the people of God. We are his people and who are called by his name. Where does it talk about us in that? It's about him, isn't it? Amen? So we can have confidence that he has delivered us, and all these promises in that song, we can trust in the Lord, can't we? Amen. I'm gonna ask you all to join us in singing this next song, if y'all know it. Y'all do this with us.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Is that your testimony this morning?
And I'm so glad I've learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Amen. Well, I praise the Lord that we can trust him. I praise God that he is consistent. We're praising him tonight for a reason. It's because he's worthy of our praise, isn't he? Amen. In the book of Revelation, John became distressed. He became heartbroken because he was standing in this vision before, he was standing in heaven, and he saw this scroll, and what this scroll represented was the redemption of man, and his heart began to break because he realized that there was no one on this earth who was sinless. There was no one who was worthy to open that scroll because that person had to be sinless, and holy and perfect. And there was none on, and there was none on earth like that. And then an angel came to John, and he said, John, why are you crying, man? Because there is one who is worthy, the Lion of Judah, who has conquered the grave. That's Jesus Christ, amen? So this song is talking about how worthy he is of our praise. Listen to this song straight from the scriptures.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. Does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. And we cry, is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory?
Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Worthy, is he worthy? He
Hallelujah. Praise God for the difference that he's made in our lives. Amen. This is one of our favorites.
Well, I've been to the river, I've been baptized, I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. And I've changed from the creature that once I was, and redeemed is now my name. I've been changed, I'm newborn now, all my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh yes, I've been changed. Though my sins were scarlet, the white as snow, I was bound, but today I am free. I was lost in the darkness, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I've been changed, I'm newborn now, all my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh yes, I've been changed. Like the poor Hebrew children, I wandered long, Ginebed, there's the land to and fro. But I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's land, where the milk and honey flow. When at last in his presence I stand above, he will wipe all the tears from my eyes. And I'll thank him for giving a wretch like me lasting hope beyond the skies. I've been changed, I'm newborn now, all my life has been rearranged. What a difference he made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh yes, I've been changed.
What a difference he made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart.
Oh yes, I've been changed. I'm newborn now, I'm changed.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I'm just so thankful for that changing power that is in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that in Christ we become new creation. And that's a literal new creation. It's not the change that happens and we keep on singing day and night, but it's a change that happens. Jesus Christ comes in and imparts his righteousness in us. Praise God for that changing power. I remember August 2nd, 2019, when I said yes to Jesus Christ and I received him into my life. I was never the same person. I have been changed. Yeah, praise God for that power of the changing power that is in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise God. And that's because of the cross. This next song we're going to sing talks about the cross. It gives an outline that says that at the cross we have peace with Jesus Christ. At the cross we have hope for tomorrow. Praise God for the cross.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you, where your love ran red. My sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus.
Listen to these words. This is the power of the cross tonight. There's a place.
There's a place where sin and shame are powerless.
Praise
God. Do you believe that tonight? Amen.
Where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. Here my hope is found. Here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow down, here arms open wide, here you saved my life, here I bow down, here I bow down, here my hope is found, here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow down, here arms open wide, here you saved my life, here I bow down, here I bow.
Sing it out, at the cross.
At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. Sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you, we owe to him, we owe to him, Jesus.
Hey, let's all stand. I think you all know that chorus well enough. We don't need to put the words up. Let's just worship the Lord for a moment. Ready?
At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. My sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus.
Give Jesus a praise. Praise God. You all may be seated. After worship like that, my allergies are kicking in. And I'm gonna admit to you tonight, my emotions are right on the edge tonight. So did you all have fun today? Had a good day, everybody? Anybody take a little excursion today? Yeah, okay, a number of you did. Some of you are too tired to raise your hands, maybe. So I took a little shopping excursion today, but we also took some time to go see the movie Sound of Freedom. How many have seen that movie? Okay, a fair number of you have. I doubt that you've ever heard a movie recommended from this pulpit all that often, but I'm just going to tell you, I think if you're probably over the age of 12, it ought to be required viewing. It's not easy viewing. I'm going to tell you that right now. I walked out of that theater just so upset, emotional, and angry. And honestly, I think if you watch that movie and you're not upset and you're not emotional and you're not angry, I think there's something wrong with you. So I just want to tell you right here and right now, if you feel like you need to go and see that movie and you don't have the financial means to do so, I want you to call me and I'll make sure that you get there. Don't miss a service at camp. But after camp, you call me and we'll make sure you get there. You know, Brother Mike, where are you, Mike? Right there. Okay. Over there. Okay. He mentioned in his sermon about slavery that there's more people enslaved now than at any time in human history. And so we know that there are people who do terrible things to other people and enslave them. But one of the reasons that we're here today is because we know that there is an enemy of our souls who desires to enslave people. And many, many more are enslaved to sin, whether they know it or not. And the devil does not intend good things for them. So that's why we're here, because we're fighting that battle as well. And so I just wanted to give you some encouragement that your efforts in the battle make a difference to people. So I wanted to share something that came our way in the office today. It says, to the camp, I want to thank you all for your kindness and generosity. I thank you for this opportunity to grow and learn about God. I feel lost. I'm not sure of what I am supposed to do next, but I am all in. Thanks for your guidance. So you all are making a difference, and I thank the person that shared this with us, and I hope it will be an encouragement to you all to keep up in the good work that we are doing. Okay, transition to some business, and ushers, if you want to get ready, I will come to you, I promise. The office and snack stand are open after the service. If you have to have any business you need to take care of, you can check in with Karen at the office. And the snack stand is also open. And just a quick reminder, if you're running a tab at the dining hall or the snack stand, make sure to clear that before you leave campus. Don't want you to leave. We're still here the rest of the week. But just make sure that you take care of those things. We want to welcome those that are joining us on the live stream, good evening. Thank you for tuning in. So I want to tell you that last night I got back to my cabin after the service and saw that I had a text message that came in during the service. And it was someone that was watching on the live stream and said, sign me up for a youth pledge. That made me happy. Yeah. And then they said, and by the way, Dan, you look good on television. That made me pretty happy, too, I'll tell you what. Now listen, my ego does not need to be stroked. I mean, it just that's just a recipe for disaster, I think. But I'm glad to, you know, they say television adds 15 pounds. So if I still look good, I guess that's a good thing. So if you're tuned in tonight, I just really want to thank you for that comment. I mean, that was fantastic. I did happen to find two unused youth pledge cards on the back table there. So would anybody be interested in taking a $50 youth pledge card? Okay, I see two hands in the back there. Gavin, could you maybe run those back? Just all you need to do tonight is just put your name and address on that card, and you can drop that in the offering when we take it up shortly. And then we'll just send a letter, and you can send that in at any time during the next 11 months, or maybe you want to just pay a little bit each month towards it. That's okay, too. You'll also find on the back table applications for membership. You can ignore the language on the back side, but on the front side, if you're interested in membership, just fill this out. You can give it to me. You can give it to Jody, and we'll see that our membership committee gets this. The requirements for membership for Peniel Camp is, first of all, that you have to have attended at least two camp meetings and that you regularly attend your church. And if you meet those two requirements, then our membership committee will meet with you to share more about what Peniel is all about and to get to know you. And then they can make recommendations about membership. So that's back there. Also, pledge cards are back there, not youth pledge cards, but just general pledge cards. And I'm gonna ask the ushers if you might just put a few in each basket as it's going around, because you might wanna take one of these. And what I like to encourage people to do is take a pledge card fairly early in the camp meeting and just put it in your Bible and pray over it for a couple of days. Pray over it for a few days and ask the Lord what he would have you do to support the camp in the next year to come here. So those pledge cards are available. There's no child watch this evening, kids. We're glad that you're here. And it's always good to have the whole family of God here in the service. Child watch will resume tomorrow evening and during every evening service through Saturday night. There's also information on the dry erase board for board members. Our minutes of our last meeting are there, so make sure to review those before our board meeting on Wednesday. We also have our statement of faith posted there for all of our members. Please take a look at that. If you do have questions about that, please feel free to see myself or any of our board members, trustee board members that are here. And I'd just like to ask if we could have those members of our board just stand so that you know who they are. And that way, if you want to touch base with any of our board members, these are the folks that are on our board. And thank you for your service. We also put on that board just a few conceptual ideas about the boys' dorm. That's not complete thought there, but just kind of a start. So you're welcome to take a look at that. Here is our schedule for tomorrow. Tuesday, breakfast at 7:30, prayer bell, 8:15, prayer meeting at 8:30 in the youth tab, and of course then our normal morning and service and dinner at 12:30. Tomorrow at 2:30 is a special service. That is our annual memorial service. That's a time that we take each year to set aside to just remember members of our Peniel family that have gone to be with the Lord in the past year. We'll remember them in that service. And if you have someone that's part of our camp family that should be remembered in that service, I'd just appreciate it if you'd let Carol Durfee know. Wave to everybody, Carol. She's in the back row there. She does a wonderful job keeping track of all of our campers. Tomorrow is also July 25th, which means tomorrow is Christmas in July. So when you come to service tomorrow, try to wear something that's Christmas themed, okay, or Christmas colors in our service tomorrow. Wednesday is Hawaiian Shirt Wednesday. So wear a Hawaiian shirt to service if you've got one Wednesday for Wednesday evening service. And Thursday is Throw Together Thursday. That means you wear something that you just threw together that probably doesn't match. If you're not sure, how to do a throw together outfit, just look at Mike Adams and you'll figure it out. All right. He's not preaching this evening, so I could get away with that one. Or, well, maybe I shouldn't have done that. Okay. And Friday is Peniel T-shirt day. And that's a day that we get together here in service, and people wear Peniel T-shirts from down through the years. So we have this year's Hope 2023 T-shirt, but many shirts from past years, and we'll see how many years we can go back with Peniel T-shirts. Now, if you don't have a Peniel T-shirt, make sure to stop up in the book room. They do have a limited supply of this year's. Do we still have some of this year's left? Okay, we have some of this year's left, and I think they have some previous years in the book room as well. And Mr. Jason wants you to know that he has OMS T-shirts that are available in the back there. I've seen some people wearing those. They are really sharp. So make sure to get an OMS T-shirt and make sure to wear your Peniel T-shirt to service on Friday. Okay, I think that's everything. So with that, I'll ask our ushers to come forward and we'll bless the offering. Father, we thank you for this day and for all the blessings that you've brought into our lives. We thank you for the opportunity to participate in this ministry of Peniel through our offerings. And we ask, Lord, you know the needs. You know the financial needs of the camp. It's never easy, but Lord, you've always provided. And so we ask, Lord, that you would do again this year what you've done in the past. And we ask for a blessing to be upon each gift and each giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Search for life's meaning, enslaved by the world and my greed. Then the door of the prison was opened by love, for the ransom was paid. I was free. I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of the past. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I am free, praise the Lord, free at last.
As the Lord set you free tonight.
I am free from the guilt that I carry, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. God, the foolish man I used to be. I am free from the fear of tomorrow. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I am free, praise the Lord, free at last.
Amen. Amen. In a holiness camp, I know that we can talk about freedom and total surrender, can't we? Amen. I praise God that he set me free from myself. And it's not exactly something of someone else doing something without your own consent. First, you have to surrender to him. Amen. That is love. That is his love. So it's when we surrender all of ourselves to him, that's when we can enjoy that freedom. Amen. Let's make this our prayer tonight.
Good evening. At this time, I'd like to share with you a little bit about Kentucky Mountain Bible College. It's good to be back with President Dan And I was rather excited to come to Peniel this year, not just because it's my second time, but because I heard you were having a great evangelist. Not Mike Adams, but David Spencer. So I just want to say thank you to David Spencer. He was newly elected as the president of the Kentucky Mountain Holiness Association, and our college is a part of that. Now, not only is David Spencer a great evangelist, but he is my great uncle. Amen. Now, people ask me, is he your uncle? And he's really good at it. Or is he your great uncle? You know, that's just a secret. That's a mystery. Both? I'm a great nephew. Amen. Amen. Well, it is so good to be here with you guys. This year has been a big year for Kentucky Mountain Bible College. This year, we've said goodbye to our president, Dr. Phil Spees, as he's retired of 29 years of service. So we've thanked him for that, and we've elected a new president, Dr. Robert Pokai. His most recent position was at Wesley Biblical Seminary as their executive vice president. So he has taken off, and he is doing an incredible job. We're proud of him. And also this year, this has been a big year for Kentucky Mountain Bible College to grow with Peniel. This year, we had a team of youth come down to our college from this camp to help us, to minister to us. We went through what was called a 1,000-year flood in our county, in our community, and it was devastated. We live on a hill, our college, but the water came up to our mailbox, practically. So I just want to say thank you to Peniel for sending this group of youth. Was anyone here involved in that? Could anyone involved in that please just stand? I would love to recognize you. Thank you so much. As I'm sharing, I would like to ask Gideon and Nathan if they would pass around these ways that you can sign up for our magazine. It's a biannual magazine. It's free, and we would love to keep in contact with you to let you know what God is doing in this next generation of spiritual leaders. I would like to bring to mind tonight that no matter what the culture of this nation is, no matter what the state is, no matter what this world adopts, that Christ is still on the throne, isn't he? Amen? And Christ is consistent, even though this world is not. And one thing about God is he is consistently calling young men and women to ministry to love people through them. So he is calling young people, like this group from Peniel, to be instruments of his love to love those people down in Kentucky. He's consistently doing that. And at Kentucky Mountain Bible College, our desire is to see those young people experience a transformation of the heart, sanctification through and through, that they can live total holiness for their life. So that is what our passion is to see young people with a desire for God, not just hunger, not just want to go all in, but that they would be able to really go all in with God, and they would be able to be transformed in their heart and life. Another thing we do at Kentucky Mountain Bible College is we train their hands. We trust that it'll be consistent, that when God does a transforming work in your life, that you're going to want to see God do it in someone else's life. So we're training young men and women to know how to minister to their friends, how to minister to the world. God says, go ye therefore, and someone's got to go. And so God is still calling up people, so we are training them to go. And at our college, we also have the opportunity to go with our feet. So in our college, not only do we have discipleship groups, we're actually rated the number one in our state for discipleship. To see that heart transformed, the ministry program is top-notch, but we also give the students an opportunity, not just to learn about ministry, but we get to do ministry. So we have a ministry team from the college, counseling team, the trio's here tonight. While at Kentucky Mountain Bible College, some will lead worship in a local church, teach a children's church, run a youth group, play guitar, anything like that, leading worship, doing ministry in the community where they're at. So I firmly believe that every young man and woman who is trying to put the Lord first in their life, I believe that they would benefit greatly from a year or 2 years of establishing a firm foundation in Christ that will last through the ages. I'm thankful that 3 years ago, whenever I was a senior in high school and was a new Christian, that God gave me Kentucky Mountain Bible College to help me keep the narrow way. I'm thankful that when I was here 2 years ago, right where Brother Gideon is sitting, the Lord confirmed to me that he had sanctified me through and through. And I can look back and I can see that work that God did in my life through my time at our college. And I just know God is wanting to do that with so many here. So I would just invite you guys to pray with me for students, for our college, from the north, the south, the east, and the west, and that God will continue to raise up a generation to revive this nation. Amen. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Kentucky Mountain Bible College. Wow, I'm so proud of this group, the ones that are working here on the grounds. And I keep running into these guys around camps in the south. And last year I run into them, I don't know how many times, but singing. And I'm certainly proud of what they're doing and how God is using them. I'm always proud of the way they conduct themselves. The Kentucky Mountain Bible College puts out some... Except for Mike Adams. I don't know what happened to him. I don't know what happened to Mike. You can get me back tomorrow night, Mike. So good. It's my great nephew. I'm proud of him, too. I asked him if he wanted to preach, and he said, sure. I said, well, maybe I better go ahead with it. I'm going to be reading from the book of Exodus tonight, chapter 3. The book of Exodus, chapter 3. And I'm going to start reading at verse 1. The book of Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place wherein thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the afflictions of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of the taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the Egyptians, and to bring them out of that land into a good land, a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel, come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression where the Egyptians have oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? I'll stop reading right there. Let's pray for the message. Father, we thank you for this passage of Scripture. Lord, we thank you, Lord, how you speak to us through your word. And Lord, I pray tonight as we look into this passage that you will just help me to share what you want me to share. I pray that you'll open our hearts to the truth, distribute the word out as you see fit to each one of us. And Lord, open our spiritual ears. You want to speak to every one of us tonight. And I pray that you'll do that right where we're at. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I preached the other night about the journey from Egypt to Canaan. And I talked about how that all of us are in one of those places. We're in Egypt, or we're in the wilderness land, or we're in Canaan. And I felt like God helped us to see some truth to that passage of Scripture. But I want to talk about Moses tonight. Moses was quite a character. I love studying about Moses and thinking about him. But I wonder how Moses got to be such a great man that he's one of the most interesting and one of the probably the most talked about characters in the Old Testament, Moses. And so I want to talk about three periods of his life. He had one period where he was being somebody down in Egypt. He had another period where he was being a nobody down in Midian. And then he spent the last 40 years being a somebody for God. So I want to talk about how Moses came from being a somebody to a nobody to a somebody for God. You know, there's a lot of different periods in our lives, and we face all kinds of personal battles. But the most important and greatest ones that are fought are the ones we fight for the Lord. That's where we need to be. We need to be in the battle for the Lord to help other people achieve God's goal and purpose in their lives. Moses fought a lot of personal battles before he began to accomplish God's will in his life. And so we find him for the first 40 years of his life in Egypt. And you know the story of how his mother built the little ark and put it in the Nile, and Pharaoh's daughter came out and found Moses and raised Moses. And Moses was raised by the grandson. He was the grandson of Pharaoh. Moses could have, if he would have stayed in Egypt, a prince of Egypt, very well could have became the Pharaoh in Egypt. And so he was a big shot. Moses was a big shot in Egypt. But somewhere along the line, I don't know where it was, it's not clear in the Scripture, but somewhere along the line, Moses realizes that he is the son of an Egyptian. Not an Egyptian, but an Israelite. He realizes that, and so Moses has to make a choice, and this is what the Hebrew writer says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. He had to make that choice. Was he going to live as a big shot there in Egypt under Pharaoh, or was he going to suffer with his people rather than to be a big shot in Egypt? And I think Moses, I can't prove this by Scripture, but I believe that Moses early on began to realize that God had a call upon his life. I think Moses began to realize that God has put me in a special position so that I can help get my people out of bondage. And so how do I see that? Well, I see it in the fact that one day Moses was out there. He saw one of the taskmasters beating, abusing one of the Egyptians, and Moses killed him and buried him in the sand. You see, I think Moses was taking things into his own hands. I think that Moses was trying to do God's will his own way. And if we're not careful, we can get caught up in doing God's will our own way, and we can mess up the whole thing. Back a few years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, I was talking to a guy that I used to run around with, and you know, a good guy. He knew a lot of people in our area, and I met him at the grocery store, and I said, you know what, you need to get in church. And he kind of puffed up, and right back he said, man, he said, God could really use me if I got saved, couldn't he? And I thought to myself, well, if he could get some air out of you, he might use you. But anyway, it went on for a while, and I heard that he was in the hospital probably a couple years later. And so I thought, I'm going to go to the hospital and visit him. And I went to the hospital and visited with him there in the hospital. And I talked to him a while, and then I said, listen, you need to give your heart to Jesus. He said, oh, he said, I've already done that. I've already given my heart to the Lord, and I knew that he was not telling the truth. But what do you say? I mean, he was a pot smoker, a whiskey drinker, a partier, and he hadn't quit doing that. And so I knew that he wasn't being honest. He just didn't want to talk to me about getting right with God. And so I couldn't say anything much about it, so I had prayer with him, and I left. And I don't know, it was probably about a year later that I got a phone call. And it was him, and he was crying on the phone, and he was crying so much that he couldn't hardly say anything. He finally got the words out. He said, Dave, he said, I'm sorry that I lied to you when you was down at the hospital. He said, I knew I wasn't a Christian, and you know I wasn't a Christian. I didn't want to talk about it, but he said, I got saved the other day, and you're the first guy that came to mind. I just wanted to call and let you know I got saved. And the Lord got a little bit of air out of him and got him in the right place. And listen, Moses was a big shot. And so I think Moses thought, I'm gonna do it my way, but we know what happened. After that, he was out there the next day, and there was two of the Israelites in some kind of skirmish, and he tried to correct them, and they said, well, what are you going to do, kill us? And he found out, wow, people know about it. You see, the first day when he killed the guy, he looked this way and looked that way and didn't see anybody, and he killed him and buried him. So he finds out that he's caught, and then Pharaoh finds out, and Moses is in real trouble, so he has to flee from Egypt, and he goes in to Midian. He goes to Midian. Moses thought that he was in charge, but he found out that he wasn't. This is what it says in the book of Galatians. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Listen, there has to come a time in our life that we die out to ourselves, we die out being a big shot, we die out doing things our way, and we do it God's way. And unless we ever, if we never get there, we'll never be beneficial in God's kingdom as long as we want to do it our way. And so Moses, he has to leave Egypt, and he finds himself down in Midian at Jethro's house, and he marries one of Jethro's daughters and has some children. And Moses knows what he's supposed to be doing. He knows what God has called him to do, but he's taking the path of least resistance. I'm going to get down here. If I go back down there, there's no telling what's going to happen to me, and I'm not going to take a chance, so I'm going to stay out here with Jethro. He's giving me a pretty good job. I'm watching his sheep, and I'm just going to stay out here. Matter of fact, the scripture says that he was content to stay with the man. In other words, he got down there, he was out of God's will, he was away from the danger, he was taking care of the sheep, and he became content. And I want to tell you, if you become content out of God's will, you are in trouble. If you get to a place where you're satisfied out of God's will, you're in real trouble. Well, he lived out there for all of those 40 years in Midian. This is his second period in his life, and God's trying to get some of the air out of old Moses out there. You know, he's got this lowly position of taking care of sheep, and he's out there. He knows that his family's back down in Egypt, and his brother and his sister and his parents and all of his family and his friends are down there, and they're under cruel bondage. He saw it year after year, what was happening to them. But he tried to put that in the back of his mind and stay out there out of the will of God and do it his own way. And I don't know. I think there was a lot of regret that he tried to hide, that he tried to oppress, you know, and keep it down. A lot of regret. I've done the wrong thing. I took things in my own hands. I messed everything up. I've just fumbled it up, and I don't know if there's anything I can do about it. But one day, Moses was on the backside of the desert taking care of the sheep, and he saw a bush burning. We read about it, and this bush was burning, and I think Moses watched it for a while, and he finally figured out there's something different about that. That thing's been burning for a while, but it's not being consumed. And so he turns aside to go see this strange sight that is happening. He turns aside to go see what's going on. And God speaks to Moses out of the bush and tells Moses, I have heard the cries of my people in Egypt, and I'm going to send you down. I'm going to send you down to deliver them through my power. And Moses said, well, who am I that I should go down there? Well, God has been getting him ready for years. God's been getting him ready for almost 80 years to be the man that goes down and does the will of God. But he's been on the road of least resistance. My daughter is working in a Nazarene church, and I don't know exactly what her title is, but she is an assistant pastor of discipleship, some title like that, and she's got three or four discipleship groups, and she's always calling me and talking to me about things, and every once in a while she'll say to me, Dad, man, that makes me uneasy about this thing, you know, and I say to her, listen, if you're doing everything that is the path of least resistance, you're not getting anything done for God. If you're just going to go the easy path, you're not going to accomplish anything. It's when God asks us to do things that makes us uneasy. It's when God asks us to do things that we can't do on our own. It's when God asks us to go the direction that sometimes we don't want to go, and we're fearful, and we don't believe we can do it, but we finally surrender to God, and He helps us to do what we cannot do. That's what God's will is. Well, I want to tell you, I hadn't told anybody, maybe one person since I've been here, that I'd been elected as the president of the Kentucky Mountain Holiness Association. And listen, I was on the nominating committee, and my name was never brought up. My name was never brought up in that committee, and so we come down to the last meeting, and what we were going to do, we're each going to write down two names, and the two top names, one would be the president, the other would be the vice president, which one got the highest vote in the next vote. And so when we turned all of our votes in, I think there was eight or nine of us, we turned all of our votes in, and my name come up at the top of the list. And they said, will you accept the nomination? I said, I don't know. I said, it's not even on my radar. And I don't feel capable of being the president of the Kentucky Mountain Holiness Association. I said, I've got to go and pray about it. I got to go talk to the Lord about this. And I said, I'll let you know next week. And so I went home and I told my wife, I said, I'm not going to accept it. That was my decision on the way home. I'm not going to accept it. I've got too much to do. I've got plenty to do where I'm at. And I could not sleep all weekend. God wouldn't let me have any peace. And I finally, somewhere about Monday morning, I said, Lord, if that's what you want me to do, I surrender it to you. I'll go and tell them I'll accept the nomination. And God gave me peace, and I went and accepted that nomination. I told my wife, I said, now that don't mean that I'm going to get the top vote, but when it came around, I got it. And I've been scared to death ever since. But wow, it's too big for me, Mike. It's too big for me. And so I have done my best to humble myself before God and say, God, I don't know how to lead this group of people. I need your help. I need your wisdom. It's too big for me. It's uneasy for me. But I just believe that God put me there, and the fact that He put me there, He is going to help me make a difference in the Kentucky Mountain Holiness Association. And so listen, We can take the path of least resistance, but it doesn't lead to the victory that God wants us to have. It doesn't lead to soul winning. It leads to being content where we are, and that's what Moses had become, content to live with the man. And so there he is. Hey, can you imagine if old Moses would have went down and told his wife, said, man, you should have been with me today. It was just great. I was up there in this bush, and God talked to me and told me he wanted to go down to Egypt. And his wife and Jethro said, Moses, you can't go down to Egypt. They'll kill you down there. And Moses, he gets to thinking about that. You know, maybe they will kill me. Maybe I better not go. And he don't go. Well, we would have never heard about Moses. And Moses could have went back up to that same place year after year, trying to experience that great experience that he had with God, but he would never experience that again. Listen, when God does something in our life and he speaks to us and he calls us and he's leading us and we reject that, don't expect God to change his mind and do something else. We're just going to be stuck there. And so Moses finally gives in. You know, he says, well, who am I? I've got a bad speech problem. Now, you know what? I had an uncle up in Pontiac, Michigan. He became a Nazarene preacher. He was a barber there in Pontiac. And I, of course, I was too young to know all these details, but my aunt told me about it. He stuttered real bad. And God called him to preach. He told his wife, he said, I'm not going to get up and make a fool out of myself. I'm just not going to do it. And he went on for a year or two fighting against God. And it got so bad on him, he knew that if he didn't preach the gospel, that he was going to backslide, that he was getting away from God. He knew he was in trouble, and he finally surrendered to preach the gospel. And my aunt told me the first time he stepped in the pulpit, he never stuttered one time and never stuttered one time after that. God delivered him from that and made a holiness preacher out of him. And so, wow, we face the big challenges of life, and if we're not careful, we'll wind up down in Midian taking care of the sheep until we die with regret in our lives. God is looking for humble leaders. He don't need people that are proud and arrogant. He can't use them. They think they're doing it on their own. And so God said, Moses, who made your mouth? I made your mouth. Don't tell me about your speech problem. I already knew about that. You just go down and do what I tell you to do. And we look at ourselves and we look at our inadequacy and we look at our inability to do what God is calling us to do. And I just believe that there's missionaries and preachers and soul winners all over the world today that did not believe that they could do what God was asking them to do. But somewhere along the line, they surrendered to God and said, ever what it is, Lord, like Mike was preaching to us last night. Listen, I came up to the altar right there and said, Lord, I'm making a brand new commitment to you. I'm making a brand new one that I'm going to, for the rest of my life, I'm just renewing my commitment to you that I'm going to do whatever you ask me to do. And so Moses, he spends 40 years being a big shot. He spends 40 years being a nobody down in Midian. Nobody don't know much about him. He's out there. His family don't know what's going on. They're just, maybe his mom and his brother and sister thought that Moses was going to be the man that delivered them. And, I read about that, and listen, they've been there for 430 years. It was a terrible place. But God said, I have heard the cries of my people, and I have seen their oppression. And this is what I imagine, that there was prayer meetings going on all over in Egypt by God's people. Listen, if we're going to be delivered from the situation we're in the United States, it's going to take people that get serious about God and get serious about prayer and cry out to God until God brings deliverance to us. And I don't know if he'll ever deliver this country or not, but he can deliver the people that live in it. And that's the most important thing. And so God hears him. He's finally got Moses to a place that he knows he can't accomplish much. Now God can use him. When we get that figured out, that without the Lord I can't do anything, he can start using us. So, you know, King Solomon said this. He was put in, and it says, "And now, Lord my God, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David my father, and I am but a little child, and I know not how to go out or come in." Humility. I don't know what to do, but Lord, I need you to help me. And so God asked him, "Well, what do you want me to do? I'll give you a lot of money, or I'll just make you wise." And he had the best answer. "Give me wisdom to know how to lead my people Israel." And God made him the wisest man in the world and then the richest man in the world because he was willing to humble himself before God. The burning bush, what an experience. Wow, what a wonderful place. The voice of God speaking to us and us, you know, just hearing the voice of God. Hey, can I share a little thing with you? I don't want to preach too long, but back several years ago, the Lord was laying on my heart to have a Jubilee service. And I thought, wow, why does the Lord want me to have a Jubilee service? I didn't have any idea. And so I thought about that for a week or two, and the Lord kept impressing it on me. And I finally said, okay, I'm going to make the announcement. We're going to set a date. We're going to have a Jubilee service, and we're going to make a big deal out of it. And so I made the announcement to the church, and we're going to have a Jubilee service. And people were asking me questions. Well, what's the Jubilee? And, of course, it's the 50th year. There's seven-year periods, and they're the 50th year. And do you know what happens on the 50th year? People that were bad managers that had lost their property and all of that, and their family, you know, is just in destitute, they get a brand-new start. They get their property back, and they get a brand-new start. So I thought, well, God may be getting ready to do something brand new for us. So we're going to have a Jubilee service. And the week before the Jubilee service, I was sitting at the altar getting ready for Sunday morning service, wasn't even thinking about the Jubilee service, and God spoke to me very clearly, and all of us that know the Lord knows how he speaks to us, and he said, "Dave, I'm going to begin to answer the prayers of the saints that's been prayed for the past 50 years. And I didn't have any idea what that meant. And I still don't know what all it means, but I know this. When I planted that church at Wide Creek, and old Luke King said to me, "I've been walking around this church for 8 years asking God to send somebody to me." I said, "God has begun to answer the prayers." And he's still doing it. And it's not just for Eastern Kentucky. Listen, God wants to pour his Spirit out on us, on the United States, around the world. And we're due for a revival to sweep around the world. And listen, folks, we need to be praying and seeking God. And I've got off track. I'm not preaching about Moses now. But that's good stuff anyway, I think. So, the burning bush. Do you remember when God filled you with his Spirit? Do you remember that day? You know, just a couple years ago, we have, I don't know if you guys have them around here, but we have graveyard meetings. That don't sound too good, does it? But we have meetings at the cemetery. It's a family reunion kind of thing, you know. And we have a big dinner, and we take our guitars and sing, and somebody preaches, and we just have a big time, you know. My great-nephew here and my other great-nephew, I told them about where I'd got sanctified and where I was in the middle of the road walking down that old dirt road. And they said to me, "Now, Dave, We want you to take us where it happened at. And so we walked down the hill, walked out the little old dirt road, and I said, boys, right here is where it happened. I'll never forget it. Right there in the middle of the road that the Holy Spirit came over me, baptized me in His Spirit. I know God that cleansed me and sanctified me. Listen, there was a burning bush experience that put a fire in my heart and thrust me out into eastern Kentucky to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and it's still burning today. Listen, folks, if Moses had not gone, the fire would have went out in his soul, and he would have never experienced that again. And I'm afraid it happens to so many people that somewhere in our past that God has set a fire in our heart, and somehow we've let it go out. I want to tell you that we need to be renewed every once in a while. We need a new infilling, a new empowering. We need the Spirit of God to come on us and empower us to do His work. We can give out and we can give out. And if we give out too much and not take it back in, pretty soon we're going to burn out. And so Moses out there at the burning bush. And God built a fire in his heart to go to Egypt. Overcame his fears. Overcame his contentment. Overcame all of the past. Okay, God, I'm going down. I'm going to do it. I'm going to go. And, of course, we know what happens as Moses goes down. But I want to say this to you. You can't live on that past experience. You can't live on the fact that you got saved back years ago. You can't live on the fact that you got sanctified back years ago. It needs to be a reality at this moment. It needs to be a reality right now. And I want to tell you that when we get sanctified, we can lose our sanctification. That, you know, just because you've been filled with the Spirit doesn't mean you can't backslide. Listen, you got to keep up with it. You got to keep at it. You got to keep letting the Lord fill you. You got to keep doing God's work. And I want to tell you that I just believe this, that holiness ground has to be worked in. It has to be worked in. Somebody asked me, Randy asked me if I had a big garden. I said, no, I've not had a garden in 3 years because I've been traveling when I need to hoe it. And when I get home, it's weeds is all it is. And so I don't have a garden. But that's the reason I didn't grow, because you got to work in it. And you can plant good seed and you can fertilize it and you can do all of that. But if you don't go out there and hoe it and take care of it, all you're going to get is a crop of weeds. And that's what I got for about 2 years. And I told my wife, as much as she loves a garden, I told my wife, we are not going to plant a garden. I've got two little rows of beans about 8 foot long at the house. And they probably got weeds in them now. Holiness ground has to be worked in. It's just not some experience. It's just not some burning bush experience. But you've got to keep at it. And so Moses, he went down to Egypt. I want to ask you this. Have you had a burning bush experience? Moses knew who he was. He was a part of God's children. And after we are born again and our sins are forgiven, there needs to be a time when we surrender all to God. We've been hearing about it. We heard about it in the songs that they sung to us about this surrendering everything to God. Listen, when I get saved, I don't know how to surrender everything to God because I don't know what's going on. I don't know anything about this Christian life. When I got saved, I didn't know anything about Christianity. But I want to tell you, I began to learn about God, learn about His ways and what He wanted me to do. And I was excited about my new relationship with Jesus Christ. And I came to a place in my life that I said, I want to surrender everything about me to God. I want to go all in for Him. I want to let Him be Lord of my life completely. And I want to do His will. We've got to get there. Mike talked about it. Jesus said in Luke, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. He tells them in the book of Acts, don't leave Jerusalem. And this is the reason. If they leave Jerusalem without the power of the Holy Spirit, the church is going to be a failure. They're going to fail in their mission. And so God tells them to tarry, to wait for the promise of the Father. And on the day of Pentecost, the Spirit of God came upon the church, and they were filled with the Spirit, and they went out into the streets of the same people that were instrumental in seeing Jesus crucified, and preached the gospel of Jesus, and told them that you put him to death. And God blessed them and kept them and used them until it was time for them to go into eternity. So where are you? If you were checking yourself up in Moses' situation, are you still trying to do things your own way? Yeah, I know God's called me, and he's asked me to do this or that, but I think I need to do it this way. I think it'd be better if I just done it this way. And, you know, when I was a young Christian and called to preach, I hadn't been preaching long enough to know hardly anything. And a little old church down the road asked me if I'd pastor that church. And I said, well, that sounds like a good idea. I found out in about 3 months it was a bad idea. Done it my own way. You know, he's called me to preach. I might as well go pastor a church. And I didn't know hardly anything. And I found out that it brought leanness to my soul, and I found out that I needed to get out of there, and it's not easy once you take a commitment and you have to say, hey, listen, folks, I just need to get out of here. I'm not ready for this, and I had people mad at me and, you know, saying, well, why'd you start if you're going to quit? But if I hadn't quit, I wouldn't be here today. I would have been out of God's will. And you know, we just want to do things our own way. Or maybe you foul things up. Moses fouled things up, and he runs down to Midian. And somewhere in the past, you've messed up, and you say, oh, well, you know, I'm just not going to do it. I'm just going to stay down here. I'm just going to be content with taking care of Jethro's sheep. Somewhere we're living in this experience. But I tell you what, I want to be in the center of God's will. And I want to tell you this, Moses was heading into a dangerous place, but I've told my church and I've told my children that in the center of God's will is the safest place in the world. It doesn't matter if you're in the middle of a war zone. It doesn't matter if you're in a place that they're going to cut your head off for being a Christian. In the center of God's will is the safest place in the world. If you lose your life, you'll never lose your soul when you're doing God's will. And so, maybe you fooled around and you've just kind of got satisfied where you're at and thinking, I'm just going to stay here. But God's been nudging you and saying, I want to do something great in your life. I want to do something great for your family. I want to do something great in your community. I want to do something great through you to be a missionary, to be a pastor, to be a song leader, ever what it might be. We're going to give you an opportunity to come and pray. Our brother's going to come and share with us, and we're going to give you an opportunity to pray this evening. Would you stand? Is it quit on you? Yeah. Amen.
I'm doing this a cappella.
Come right here. Just do it a cappella. They can hear you.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes.
Anybody need to pray?
Upon Jesus.
Is God speaking to you? Is there a call on your life? And you
look full,
just want to get that surrender to the Lord?
Face and the things
others need to
of
come.
Earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. He's all I need. He's all I need.
You need to come.
He's real to me. He's real to me. Jesus is real to me. He's real to me. He's real. If you'd like to be seated while they're praying here with these at the altar, if you need to leave, just leave quietly.
Thank you.
Oh, we're in the presence of Jehovah tonight. Father, we thank you for these who have come. And Lord, as we continue to just have this be a time of prayer and of seeking you, may you meet the needs of those who have come here to seek you tonight. And Lord, I can't help but feel that in a crowd this size, there's others of us who are still in Midian. We're still running from what God wants for us, or we're still in a place where we're comfortable and we don't want to be put in a situation where we're uncomfortable. We're afraid to step out and do what you've called us to. And so, Lord, I just pray that you'd help each and every one of us to be mindful of your Holy Spirit, and that you'd continue to pull on our hearts and our minds and our spirits to respond to you during this encampment. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, you guys are prayed through. Well, if there's anyone else that wants to come and pray, this place is always open for you. And let's just stand together. And I want to invite you just to grab the hand of the person next to you. Tell them that God loves them, that you love them too. And make sure to give Mike Adams a good hug tonight. He took a few slings and arrows tonight. I mean, even students from KMBC. Man, God bless you all. Have a good evening.